All right, let's get started.
All right. So we've kind of broken up this workshop into two sessions. I'll be doing part one, REST API basics, a tour of Cisco Spark API, and the documentation. And if we have time, do some Postman and Python examples.
And I will be demonstrating the second part of the presentation, which is about chatbots. What are chatbots? What are the purpose of using it? How integrations work versus creating new bots, getting started with a new API, and start out your chatbot. And we're going to be using a website called Cloud9. If you want to prepare in advance, go to c9.io to create an account. We have no affiliation with them. It's just a really quick and fast way to deploy an application up on a server and on a live domain without paying anything. And I'll show you how to make a couple webhooks, which is, webhook is like a notification that makes things happen and connects things together. And then we're going to test your bot.
Cool. All right.
And who are we again? Can't remember.
We're Cisco DevNet.
Yes.
All right. So what is Cisco DevNet? We are Cisco's developer program. Our purpose is to provide the tools and resources to developers to use many of Cisco's APIs. We go to lots of programming events, especially Tessa. She travels a lot. And we go to lots of conferences to show you how to use those APIs. We're also on Facebook and Twitter, so you can follow us at Cisco DevNet. And if you check out our website, developer.cisco.com, you get access to lots of free tools and sandboxes. Sandboxes are our testing environments, so you can learn how to use some of our APIs.
Can you guys hear her in the back? You guys can hear her all right? Okay.
Okay. All right, first question. What is an API? API literally stands for Application Programming Interface. It's a way for two pieces of software to talk to each other. So when I first looked at Application Programming Interface, I had to like break it down. Application, okay, that's like apps. Facebook and Twitter. Programming, okay, so I'm gonna learn to program those apps. And then interface, okay, that's a way for me to interact with the software. So that's literally, if you break it down, what it means. And so I'm gonna dive a little bit more into detail of giving you some examples so you get a better understanding of it. So for a long time, humans were the only users. So let's say you needed to get some information. You'd go onto your computer, onto your browser, and you would use the interface, which is your web browser, to get that information. Let's see. So here, user asks for data like, oh, I wonder what my friends are doing on Facebook. So they'll log on to facebook.com, and their browser is the user interface, and they can see literally that information. But what if the user was another piece of software? What if your application wanted to get that data? Find out what's my latest news feed? So here in this diagram, we have software asks for data or takes action by interacting with an API. So you have one piece of software that wants to get information from another piece of software. And then this software will return the results via an API. We'll keep working on it a little bit more. So why are APIs so important? Next slide. These are some of the big APIs out there. You have Amazon Web Services, Tropo, Google, Facebook, Twitter, Uber, GitHub. All of these companies have opened up APIs. And you can see over time, in 2000, Salesforce and eBay were the first ones to have an API. And by 2016, there's about 30,000 APIs out there. So this industry has grown exponentially.
And it's been doubling every year for the past few years. So by the end of this year, there should be 60,000 APIs out there.
Pretty impressive.
And it's really easy to make your own API. So maybe after this workshop, you can go out and, or you can just ask me. I have a few resources to give you. It's fun to create.
All right. So the API is the user interface for software systems. So it allows your software to get information from another piece of software. And APIs are a set of requirements that govern how one application to talk to another. So let's give you a little analogy. So you can think of kind of as an electrical outlet as an API. So I need to charge my phone or whatever, and well, I have an adapter because I'm from America, but all of the outlets in Germany are going to look exactly the same, right? And so the companies that create electronics, they're going to have the same specifications on their electronics so that the two can connect and, in essence, talk to each other. So here's an analogy. What it would be like to power a hairdryer without an outlet. Without an outlet, right? You'd have to open the wall, unsheath the wires, splice the wires together, and make sure you've got all the voltage correct, and then put the two pieces together. But this electrical outlet is a nice interface, so I don't have to do all of that, and I can literally just plug it in. So I'll give you another analogy. So if you've got like drill bits and screws, so you're not going to want to use like this drill bit to screw in this one, right? So REST APIs are very like specific architecture style so that one piece of software can talk to another piece of software. Does anyone have any if anyone has questions, feel free to raise your hand. Okay.
So a good example is Yelp, the Yelp API. So without APIs interacting with each other, there would be no Yelp. You won't be able to look up a restaurant and be able to get a pinpoint address giving you directions. So the Yelp API is working with the Google Maps API, and together Yelp is successful.
Yep. So can anyone else think of other applications that use Google Maps? Yes. Uber.
Yes.
That's correct. So Uber uses Google Maps APIs. They use their APIs to help give directions to the driver, to find out the closest driver next to you to pick up, and so forth. APIs are often referred to as an engine of innovation. So if you just imagine all the possibilities, think of all of the apps that you have like on your phone, and but most of them have open APIs. And just imagine just pick one, Twitter and
Facebook.
Yeah, Facebook. Like, what could you do with Twitter and Facebook APIs and create a new application, right? Something innovative.
You can create an integration where you post on Twitter and it automatically posts on Facebook.
Yeah.
Save yourself 5 seconds a day. That's what I do. It works.
So now that we've got a nice, overview of how this works, we're actually going to look at a little more technically what this looks like. So for an example, you're on your computer, you go to your browser, and you'd like to see the DevNet homepage. What the browser is doing is sending a request to the web server, And the web server prepares the HTML for that particular page. And then the web server sends it, the HTML, to your browser. And then your browser displays that HTML like as a nice, pretty user interface. Does that make sense? All right.
It's good enough for me.
All right, so now we're going to get a little bit technical. Okay, so when the browser talks to the web server, this is called a request because it's requesting information. And then when the web server sends that HTML to your browser, this is called a response. So what we're going to be talking about are REST API requests and response.
And with HTTP response codes, there's like the 100s, there's 200s, there's 300s, and every section, every group of 100 is a different type of response code. So like, for example, 404 not found, so everything in the 400s are related to that. But there's only, 10 common ones you'll see. So if you want to look up the whole list, there's several. I mean, there's so many response codes that you can look up. So when you make a request, you'll always get back some kind of response mm-hmm. in a code form.
Right. So every response contains a response code. So can someone tell me, do you think 200 okay is good or bad? Good. Yep, that's correct. Just making sure you're still paying attention. So these are some of the common HTTP status codes. So if it begins with like a 200, you're good. It means it worked. Whatever you're doing, it worked. And then the rest are usually 400 and 500 errors. If they're 400, that means you did something bad in the request. Something wasn't right on your end. And if they're 500 errors, then something wasn't right on the server's end.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so just to reiterate, your app will send a request using the API to another app, and then that app will send data in the form of a response to your app. So we got request and response down. It's kind of intuitive.
Yeah, by now it's easy stuff.
Right, right.
Super easy.
Okay. How many of you are familiar with Spark? Raise of hands. Raise them high. Come on. You'd be like, oh, yeah,
that's
I use
good.
Spark. Yeah, okay.
We're not invisible. Yay.
Okay. So Spark allows you to chat in rooms, allows you to chat with people directly. It allows you to set up like meeting rooms. There's also a lot of other features. You can actually do a conference call in Spark and also do a video as well. But we're just going to talk about the chat features.
And if anyone's used Skype before or Slack, it's along the lines of that kind of collaboration tool. But better.
Yeah,
I got
but
paid
Spark's,
to say that.
Spark's better. Okay, so let's say, so in Spark, you're going to be in, several different rooms. And we'll actually go over that and show you what that looks like. But let's say in your browser, you'd like to see all of the Spark rooms that you're a part of. So your browser will send a request to Spark. Spark prepares the data containing a list of all the rooms that you're in and provide that list in a JSON format. JSON is just a structuring style. You'll see it a little bit later. But then the browser will interpret that list.
And if you haven't heard of the acronym JSON, it stands for JavaScript Object Notation. It still confuses me. It's too long.
Okay. And so here, when you're working with APIs, you'll start reading documentation and you're going to start hearing API consumer or API provider. The consumer is the client that is requesting the information, and the provider is the one providing that information, right? So when your browser, when you look in your browser to get a list of your Spark rooms, your browser is sending the request. Using the get method, we'll go over that in a little bit. And using the rooms endpoint, we'll go over that in a little bit as well. And then Cisco Spark sends the response, and if with the JSON data, and if it looks good, it's going to also provide the status code 200 OK. OK. So here's an example. So let's say you've built an app, and you want to get all of the members in a particular room. So your app, your piece of software, will use the Cisco Spark APIs to request the information. And then Cisco Spark will return the member data via the API back to your app. And then your app can then compare members of a room with the team members, like in your company. And then you can see the difference of the users on the team in your room. So earlier I had discussed methods. So in all of these examples, I've been using the get method, where your API consumer wants to get information from the server. What if your API consumer wants to create something and add it to the database? So for instance, in Facebook, let's say you want to post a new a feed. Your app will then use the post method, which means create, and then send it to the cloud and update the servers. Another example is put. So let's say you type something on Facebook in your feed, and you have a typo and you want to update it. You want your app, your software, to update it. The method that you would use to update it would be put. And then if you wanted to delete it, like, oops, I don't really want to write that, I changed my mind, the method would be delete. I think for this session, we're just going to focus on get and post. So getting information from the server and then creating new information for the server. All right, what is so great about REST? Who here is familiar with HTTP? Raise your hands. Nice. OK. So REST is an easy-to-use architectural style that uses HTTP. And if you're familiar with HTTP, then you practically already know REST. What's awesome about it is that it's independent of programming languages. So you can whatever programming language that you're familiar with can use REST APIs. And you use REST APIs to build mobile apps, so apps on your phone, console apps, or web apps, so like for the desktop, like in that example. All right.
Let's get set up.
Woo! Okay, everybody has their laptop up, ready, charged. Let's go ahead and create. If you don't have an account, go ahead and create an account with Spark. So just go to web.ciscospark.com, create an account. It's totally free, doesn't ask for your credit card information or anything like that. And you're gonna have to do this to do the rest of the workshop.
So after the setup, you should have two browser tabs open, one for the Spark application and one for the developer portal for Spark. So you'll be interacting with the back end on the developer portal, where you can get your API key, where you can create webhooks and do all sorts of things.
Yep. So after you've created your account with Spark, you can then view the Spark app in two ways. You can view it in your browser by logging in here, or you can also download the Spark app to your computer. You can also download the Spark app to your phone as well, or your tablet.
And we'll give you about 5 to 10 minutes to get this set up and use the restroom, or grab a cup of coffee, grab a juice, or a bag of chips, or a banana, healthy, unhealthy.
Yep.
This morning I had yogurt with gummy bears on the top, so I met in the middle.
All right, yep, so we'll give you about 5 minutes to get set up and go through these steps.
Yes, question.
Yes.
So I mean, I've already presented and I want to present it to my partners like that because my decks I've seen so far are not like this, and it's really nice to introduce it like this.
Absolutely.
Hello.
All right, we're going to get started.
All right. This is the fun part. Okay, so what is Cisco Spark? Spark allows you to message other people, have meetings, and also create calls. This app is really pretty simple to use, and we're gonna walk through some steps of creating a room and adding people to a room. And then after that, we're gonna use the APIs to create a room. All right. So Spark, as I said, can be used on your mobile phone, on your tablet, on your desktop. It's all in the cloud, and it's all encrypted. And remember when I said, oh, you could send people messages, add people to rooms, you can actually create teams. These are specific endpoints for those particular those API resources. And then, as I said, get, post, put, delete. So you can get a list of people, right? You can get the rooms that you're in. Post, you can create a new room. Put, you can update maybe the team name. So these are your methods. These are like your action verbs of what you can do. And then these would be like your nouns of who or what you're doing to those particular things. And here's a nice little chart of all the what you can do: get, post, get, plural, put, and delete. And if you notice, put is missing for here for messages. So what do you think? Does anyone know like what that means? Like why don't they have put here? Any ideas? Yeah. What was that? You can't update a message, correct. So what you can do is you can create a new message. And if you don't like it or you have a typo, you can delete it and then create a new message. But it doesn't allow you to update the message.
Just like Twitter.
Yeah, just like Twitter. So you can't say like, oh, you know, the report's due Friday and then like change it and be like, and Friday comes along and then change your message to like, no, the report was due Thursday or something like that, you know? That's the only like use case that I can think of. So. All right. We're gonna do a demo now using a Spark. And first we're gonna do it, what we're gonna do is get a list of rooms that you are a member of. And we're gonna use the app first to do that. And then we're gonna actually use the API to do that same thing. So I already said that. But so we're gonna use the browser to get the list of rooms. This is like the human interaction. We're gonna do that first. How do you do that? Well, if you're looking at the Spark app, you basically just go to the Spark app and look at it, and you can see your list of rooms. So if you just created a new Spark account, you'll see your rooms here.
So and one room will show up as default when you create a new account, just to show that it's working.
Right. And so in this example, what is the name of my room? Right. Sample room. Okay. Now we're going to do the same thing. We want to get a list of the rooms that we're in using an API. Right? So I'm going to have my software talk to the Spark server to get the list of rooms that I'm in. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use the method get, because I want to get data. I'm going to use the endpoint rooms, because I want to find information about the rooms. And I'm going to send that request to Spark, and then Spark will send me the response. So let's actually do that. Okay. So is everybody, go to your browser to developer.ciscospark.com. It should look like this. Are we all on here? Yep. And go ahead and click on documentation. And in the documentation, we're going to look particularly at this API reference section in the documentation. This you can think of an API reference guide. You can think of as your dictionary that shows you how to use those particular APIs. So what do I want to do is get a list of rooms. So go ahead and click under API reference, click on rooms, and then click on list rooms. And then you should have a screen that kind of looks like this.
This is a built-in tool in our developer portal where you can create API calls and test stuff through there.
Right. So this is an interactive document. So it shows you like how to use the API. And then you can actually make those requests in the document itself. So let's see. Next. First thing that you want to do is turn on test mode. So up here, just click on it and turn it from off to on. And then let's actually look at what we're seeing here. If I want to list the rooms, the method is get, so that's already set for me. This is the URL. So as you can see, slash rooms is the endpoint. And it's already filled out for you. And if you look here, authorization, this is your own personal token. That should already be filled out for you as well. And then you have parameters. I don't see like a check mark here for required, so that means that these parameters are optional. So this is the request that I'm sending to Spark. It's already filled out for us. So go ahead and click run.
For those who are brand new to APIs, it works for all APIs. If you want to work with, let's say, you know, the Facebook API, the first thing you go to is the documentation page, and then you look at the API reference, and you look at the different parameters you can use for each section. Everything is consistent for learning any API.
So after you click run, you should see something like this. I'm in like 1,000 Spark rooms right now, but you, if you just created it, you should probably just see one. And if you look at the title, it should say sample room. So what you've done is you've gotten a piece of software to get data from Spark, and Spark then sends that data in this. This is what the response looks like. And so earlier I had mentioned JSON. JSON is just the way of structuring information. This is what JSON looks like here. So you would just look at title and you could see then that the title of that room is would be sample room if you're a new user. So congratulations, you just made your first API request. Woo!
Woo! Yay. Does that mean they're done or is there more?
No, there's more. Okay, so that one was pretty basic. You didn't have to do much. It was kind of filled out for you. Let's do something else. Let's create a new room. How does that sound? So first we're going to create a new room in the app using the user interface, and then we're going to create a new room using the APIs. All right, so to create a new room in the app, you're going to click on this little plus sign here, and now I want you to ask two people next to you for the email address that they used for Spark, so that you can add them to the room. Oh, I switched one and two. One should be, I just realized that. So go ahead, ask your neighbor for their email address. Because you can't create a room with nobody in it. You have to create a room with somebody in it. So go ahead, ask your neighbor for their email address that they use for Spark and add them to that room. What? Yeah, we're going to do that next. Like, I wanted to have them do it. Yeah. So I'm going to have you. So you're going to create a room through the app first, and then we're going to create a room through the API.
Give it another minute. They're yep. still talking amongst each other. Does anyone need more time? Yes?
Yeah.
Okay.
It is. I didn't know that. Okay. Okay. But does it still say room? Like you click on that arrow. Oh, like click on that arrow. Oh. Okay. Are we good, or you need another minute?
Let me know if you have any questions over here. Questions? We're all good? All right, let's proceed.
All right. Okay. So hopefully you have two rooms here, and I just found out that this might also be called a space now in Spark 2.0. So I'm just going to stick to room, but if you happen to see it called space later on, it'll be the same thing. So you should have two rooms here, your sample room and the new room that you just created with your neighbor. All right, so we did the human way of creating a room. Now, let's use the APIs to create a room. All right, so here's your mission. We're gonna use the documentation to create a room called new ideas. Because we're creating a new room, the method will be post instead of get. The endpoint will be rooms. And whenever you click run, what it's doing is sending that request to the Spark server.
Don't create it yet.
Yeah, I'll walk you through creating it. creates the room and prepares the response. And then Cisco Spark will send a 200 okay over saying, yep, you've created it. So let's walk you through that. So go ahead on the documentation page. I know we're going back and if you notice, we're going back and forth between the app and the documentation. So if you get confused, let me know.
Yep, make sure you have those two browsers open because you'll be going back and forth frequently.
So on the documentation page, under rooms, click on create a room. And you'll see that the method is already filled out. It says post. The URL is filled out. The endpoint is rooms. The content type authorization is filled out. And here, oh, I should have updated this slide, is the title of your new room. So go ahead, call it whatever you want. This will be the title of your new room. And as you can see here in the documentation, there's a check mark that says required. So if you tried to run it without this, you would get an error. All right, so everybody type in the title of your new room and then click run. And you should see something like this. You should see right here where it says 200 success. So this is your status code saying it worked. Do you have any questions or do you have issues? Were you able to do it? Yeah? So you see a response, it says 200 okay. Your next step is to see, did it actually work? Go to your Spark app and see if that room is there. Is it there, the new room you created? Awesome, good job. Yeah, I don't know why. All right.
Can you go back to create room? Scroll down. I think yours is the only one that's doing that. It's okay. It does the same thing. You're creating a room. That's fine. Any questions?
No, I think that's it. Thank you.
Oh, perfect. Do you have any questions or are you just listening?
All right, so are we all good? Because going further, we're just going to keep building on top of what we've learned.
Get over here.
Until we get to chatbots.
Good. You guys good?
Yeah, and feel free during this time to look at the documentation and play around with it. You know, have fun with it. You can't break it, you know? Go ahead, try. But yeah. All right. I think we're good.
Yep, we can move on.
The next step is to add people to this new room that you just created. All right. So how do you do that? You to add people to a new room, you're going to use what's called memberships. Right, so you want to create a membership between the person and the room. So to add a person to a room, click on memberships and create a membership. And your page should look like this. So we're creating a membership. So the method we want to use is post, right? If you look at the endpoint, it's slash memberships. The authorization should already be filled out for you. And you're going to have to fill in two of these values. Let's see. Oh, I'm surprised that's not required. I mean, because
the email?
Yeah, I mean, because you're creating a membership between a person and a room.
Yeah, that's,
I'm not sure.
That doesn't matter.
So the first thing that we want to fill out is the room ID. The room ID, here it says type string. So the room ID is going to look like something like this, like just a string of numbers and letters that make no sense. So how do you get the room ID to add somebody to that room? The first thing that we did was get a list of all of your rooms. And in that response was the room ID. So let me go back to that slide.
The very first API call that you made to list your room, go back to that and look at the response and find the ID of your room by viewing the title, your test room that you created. Copy the ID of your test room that you first created. Mm-hmm.
What was your question?
Or any room that you want to add people to through API calls. So go to rooms, list rooms.
Okay.
Run it and copy one of the IDs to the room that you're going to be interacting with.
This identifier is, this ID is a unique identifier. So every room is going to have a different ID.
For example, if you're posting a message, how does the API know where to post the message to without knowing the room ID? So that's how it distinguishes the difference.
Another thing is when we initially created a room, the response provided us the ID as well. And so you can use that ID for the membership. So you want to copy that string. When you copy the string, you don't include the quotes, just the string inside of the quotes. Okay. So you want to copy the string here, and then to add a person to it, so you already received or got your neighbor's email address, you can add that email address here, and it will add that person to that particular room. And then you can go ahead and click run. And when you click run, it should look like this. You should have 200 success, and it'll display the person that you added and show that it added them to that particular room in the response. Oh, Tessa, can you help her?
Yeah.
Yes. Scroll up.
And the email address.
Tess.
The room ID is.
Oh. Can you try opening it in a different browser, maybe? I don't know.
I don't know. It's a different string. Yep, perfect.
If it says 200 success, that means you did it correctly.
You connected to the internet? Maybe you lost internet connection?
Any questions so far?
Okay.
Anyone need more time?
We're going to need a little more time.
Okay.
Okay, go ahead and sign in again.
Oh, I was like, oh my God, my heart is so loud. I'm having like a panic attack.
Oh, can't hear anything. Huh? Alive? I'm just checking. Trying to make the make sounds come out. I'm trying to entertain myself.
Oh. Yeah, just type in. Just start typing. Or copy-paste.
Imagine if I can get, like, my thoughts in here. It'd be really loud. It'd, like, be nonstop through the microphone.
Mm-hmm.
So if you have a few minutes to spare, go ahead and click on different areas of the API reference and explore what it has to offer and different things you can change. And ignore the webhooks area. Nice. We will be working with that section in the second half of the workshop.
Your neighbor's email address, where it says person email. Uh-huh. No, person. Email.
So you should be able to work with people, rooms, memberships, and messages.
Mm-hmm. So just like a room has an ID, every person has an ID. So. It would be whoever you want to add. So you could. This is either or. You can add their specific ID, or you could add their email.
Just a reminder, if you do not know where the coffee is, it's directly diagonal from us, the coffee and juice bar. They have fresh squeezed orange juice there. It is so good. I drank it too fast. I forgot what it tasted like.
Okay, we're good to go.
All right.
So I have a trick question. What would happen if you tried to add yourself to your own room?
You're gonna break it.
Go ahead and try it out. Try it out and tell me what happens. So add your own.
I actually never tried that, so I don't know.
Add your own email address to that same room and tell me what happens. What is that? 409. Yeah, you get an error. You're already a member of the room, so you can't add yourself again. It says add your neighbor to your room. We did that. challenge, list memberships for a room.
Well, they can do that, and they can add a message to a room. That one's a fun one, because you can see a big difference. So let's do that first. List memberships for rooms. So what area of the API reference do you need to go to? Anyone know? The memberships, yes.
Yep.
Memberships, and you're going to create, which is the same thing as a post method. And if you've noticed, there's two different types of post methods. One is posting. There's a whole list of get get, you know how you'll see get twice in each section? You're getting a whole list, or you're getting a specific ID from that list. So that's why you'll see it twice. Two different types of get, because you can get a whole list or just get one item out of that list. But ID is, this is a different section. Oh yeah, that one's the same.
All right, what was the question? They're actually
different. So this is the ID of the particular response, and I can tell that they're different. Let's see,
they start generating different at the second round.
Yeah.
What? That's weird.
Yeah. So it's like 3VZL01, 3VZL1B, and then the rest is all different. So this is the ID of the response. This is the ID of every person. So every person is given a unique ID. So every person is going to have a different ID. Every room is going to have a unique ID. Let's see. And here you can also see the timestamp.
Make sure you have the room ID copied on your clipboard so you can use it again. And if you successfully did that part, go ahead and try to create a message to the room of your choice.
Mm-hmm.
And then after you click run, go back to your web application and see your message posted to the room.
Yeah. So if you wanted to create a message, where in the documentation should you look to create a message? Right, in messages. Mm-hmm.
See, it's so easy. We should have brought that red, big red button that says that was easy, and you push it. That was easy. After every section. I'm going to do that. Oh my goodness.
That's good.
Oh my goodness.
That's good. Denise, how are we on time? Oh, wow. Like, the rest
I
is...
I can always start the next section.
Yeah, the rest is Python and Postman, okay. And I don't really want to do, though.
Yeah, let's move to... Let's maybe give them a five-minute break, and then I'll get set up.
All right.
Well, I don't have anything to say.
So, we are going to take a quick 5-minute break. Go ahead and use the toilet or grab a coffee, orange juice, and when you return, we will get started on building chatbots.
We'll go ahead and give you a 10-minute break because the restrooms are the closest.
She's too nice.
Well, the closest toilets. There's you go through the big double doors through there, and then there's a hallway to the right. So we'll go ahead and give you a nice 10-minute break. Get up, stretch.
So come back at 10:31 a.m. Well, they don't use a.m. p.m. here, so 10:31.
Oh.
So going back a few slides, I wanted to mention another tool called Postman, P-O-S-T-M-A-N. It is similar to what we were doing, making those REST API calls, but the tool that we were using is for Spark API only. This tool here at getpostman.com is for testing and forging API requests for any API that you want to work with. So it's completely free to use. It's a plugin for Google Chrome. It's a MacBook application you can download from the App Store for free. And it's really easy to use. All the information you need to input on the form is right in the API documentation. Yeah. So just letting you know, this is another option to use and something that all developers should know about.
Yeah. So Spark's documentation is interactive. It allows you to make the request within the documentation. When you go to look at API documentation for other products, they might not have interactive docs like Spark. And so that's when you would want to use Postman. And I'll just give you a quick preview of what that looks like. But you would enter in the URL up there, and you would set the method, get, post, put, delete. You would have your authorization here, and you can click send, and then this would be your response. That's what it would look like. So we're not going to actually go through this tutorial, but we just want to make you aware of this tool. So that you can learn how to make these API requests for other APIs.
All right, let's get started.
Any questions on that? Or sorry,
I guess they can have a question. You guys ready for chatbots, or do you have any questions involving the first part of the workshop? Good.
Good.
All right, so.
Oh, do you want me to click the slides for you?
Oh, sure.
Okay.
So we're going to, as I went through in the very beginning, we're going to start out by going over what are chatbots and what the purpose of learning about it is, and getting started with the Spark API and using a cloud deployment application service. And we're going to create webhooks and make your bots work. So here are the three things we're going to be using. Have your developer.ciscospark.com web tab open. You should already have an account there. You're going to have a Cloud9 account, c9.io. If you're familiar with local tunnels, that's another option to use, localtunnel.me or ngrok, but it takes a lot longer to set up and a lot more steps. With Cloud9, it's just a few steps and you have your application launched. Unfortunately, it requires a credit card to sign up for a free account. If you do not have a credit card, just let me know and I can add you and send you an account. Let's go around and get people set up with Cloud9. Like, I don't want anyone entering their credit card information. I can do it right on my laptop. Let's do that. I'm going to go around and get everyone set up on a Cloud9 account.
Yeah, so basically we can give you, Cisco has an educational license. And so we can add you to that account so that you don't have to enter in your credit card information. And you can just use Cloud9 for free. So she's going to go around, get your email address.
Maybe we should create a
Spark. Okay. Yeah, and we're ahead of time, so we're good. So why do we need to set up a Cloud9 account? We're going to create a chat bot. And that needs to live somewhere. It needs to live somewhere that has a public IP address so that Spark can interact with it. So that's why we're creating a Cloud9 account, because we're going to host that chatbot on Cloud 9, and Cloud 9 will give us an IP address or basically a domain to use so that it can interact with Spark. Oh. The other link is the JSON viewer. So JSON is that structured text. It's, you know, formatted and has the quotes and colons and all that stuff. Whenever you're if you're sending data to a server, you want to make sure that your JSON is valid. And I think this viewer will allow you to validate that JSON as well. Oh, maybe. Do you think you could get a find?
Let me get a piece of paper.
Unless.
Why not create a Spark room and have everybody join?
Because you have to. Well, we still have to get everybody's email address.
Right, but they could all put their emails in the Spark room.
I know. Oh. What Spark room? You have to be invited to a Spark room.
Oh, I see. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So you still need your email address. Darn it.
I know. I know.
Okay, will you add me?
I don't know how to do it. It's only Tessa.
Are you allowed, like, in advance of a workshop to email everybody?
We don't get their emails.
But it's actually, the Cisco Live team would email
they
for you guys.
Care.
No, no, but they will. I've done this before. You tell them what message you want sent to them, like, in preparation for the workshop.
But the problem is that DevNet's first come, first serve, and you don't have to register.
Do what?
if Tessa could borrow your laptop, maybe.
Oh, sure.
Hers is, she's,
you could.
While she's going around getting everyone set up with a Cloud9 account, go ahead and install the JSON Viewer browser plugin. That's completely optional. Without the plugin, when you see a request on a browser, it's going to be a bunch of jumbled up words. With the plugin enabled, it'll look very beautified and pretty on your browser and eligible to read. And just a quick note, what local tunnels is it kind of gets around the IP on your local host and gives you like a tunnel onto the internet. So you can create like a fake version where your website will work right on the internet.
Right.
And you can create like an IP to access your application. There's a lot of steps to it, so that's something you can check out later instead of using Cloud9, but Cloud9 is really easy to use. There's another one I mentioned. Do you remember the one I was talking about yesterday? It's really great. I was talking about it on Twitter.
I don't remember.
All right, I'm ready.
Okay.
So the objective of the SparkBot is going to look like this at the end. You're going to make a command, and your bot is going to respond to your command. You're going to say hello, and it's going to say hi back to you. Next. So what are chatbots? Is anyone familiar with any kind of chatbots that people use every day? Can anyone name a type of chatbot? I have one in my pocket. if anyone remembers Clippy from Microsoft Windows 95 or way back in the days, you can ask Clippy a question and it'll go through its database and respond based on what your question is. So that's kind of a chatbot. Siri is another type of chatbot that responds to voice commands. It has a complete database of sounds, voice recognition, and it responds based on what your question is. It's much more complex, though. Amazon Echo is another type of chatbot. People use this to order items off of Amazon, right? I haven't used one before. I heard that they can listen and log your personal information at home, so I never got one. Funny story with the Amazon Echo, they were talking about how great this product is on the news. So they did a demonstration on how to order something off your Amazon Echo with a command. So they said, Amazon Echo, order laundry detergent, or whatever the item was. And it fired off hundreds of thousands of people's Amazon Echoes to order that product. And there was a lot of complaints towards the news station. They never did that again. So one of our VPs at Cisco, he likes to write code. He created an API integration between between Amazon Alexa, the chatbot, and the Tesla model. And the Tesla has an API, so you can actually work with an API like Spark or with Amazon Echo or with anything and make your car do things. I wish I had a Tesla. If I had a Tesla, I'd probably be writing plugins for it too.
I'd call you Tessa with a Tesla.
Tesla. I can't even tell you how many times I've said, "Hi, my name is Tessa," and they responded with, "Tesla? Like the car?" I accept anything. But yeah, this is a great article. So the reason why we're coming out and we're talking about chat APIs is because it's becoming a big thing and something that everyone should be familiar and aware of, how chat APIs work. The economy is growing. And so what are the benefits of knowing how to use them? Chatbots, you have a problem and the chatbot wants to solve it. Another thing that you can do is integrations with your chatbot. So think of Spark and think of other types of softwares working with it. So for example, Smartsheet is kind of like a Google Spreadsheets or Microsoft Excel. So whenever an update happens, it posts to your room, for example. So you can have integrations for your rooms to get information from other tools that you use. And another integration that I really like is the meme bot. Memes actually have its own API where you can write software to make it create memes with a bot command. So that's kind of fun if we're feeling silly.
So you can see in this example, to the meme bot, they wrote, "We will test in production." And then it says Insanity Wolf. So the meme bot takes that text and takes the Insanity Wolf image and displays it like that. So that's how the chatbot works. You provide it input of what you want it to do, and then it will do something.
So when you go to the bot section of the developer portal, which I'll show you in a little bit, there's two options you can do. You can create a new integration for a bot, or you can create a new bot. So just quickly going over what an integration is. An integration acts as you and can see and do things that you can do. So for example, the out-of-office assistant, it's doing a whole list of different types of access. So your integration can post and delete messages on your behalf. It can list titles of rooms that you're in on your behalf. So this is a whole list. So when you're creating a new integration, the first thing it asks you is, what kind of access rights do you want your integration to have? What do you want it to be able to do? So a bot appears as another member of the room, but you can only see messages that mentions it. So let's go ahead and get started with the Spark API that you're already familiar with. So make sure, as we did through the beginning, have two browsers open. You need to have your developer portal up and your web application up. So same as before. And also, have a third tab open, which is your Cloud9 account. And if you did not get the email that was sent to you to sign up for an account, make sure you ask Denise for help on getting another invite sent.
Right.
Unless you want to create your own account.
Yeah, so she asked you for your email address. Go check your email account and make sure that was done.
And if you don't see it in your inbox, check your spam folder, check your junk folder, check all the folders.
All right, you guys ready?
I'm ready.
Woo! Okay.
So the first thing you need to do is go to developers.cisco.com and click on My Apps at the top right corner. And then you click on the big plus sign because you want to create a new app on your developer account. And it's the same thing with other API developer sites. There should be a My App section when you want to create a new app. So you want to select Create a Bot. Do not select Create Integration. We're creating a new bot. So make sure you type this URL down. This is going to, you are required to select an image for your bot. If you know where there's an image, a 512 by 512 image somewhere, you can use that image. Or you can use this URL. So go ahead and type it down, bit.ly/sparkbot-512x512. Let's give it a minute so they can finish typing. So you're going to use this URL in the next slide. Anyone need more time? Good? All right. Next slide. So you're going to create a display name at the very top. So that's the name you're going to see in the Spark room. The second name is your bot's username. That's your unique identifier, your unique ID. You cannot use this name because it is now taken. Think of it like an email address, but that's your bot's username. So, you know, to make sure it's unique, you can put maybe your first name or your last name dash bot dash test or something like that. And copy your bot's username somewhere on a notepad. So it'll be your bot's name at sparkbot.io. So make sure you include the at sparkbot.io at the end. And then for your icon, copy and paste that URL. And the image should automatically pop up. And then submit. And raise your hand if you're having some issues, and we'll get you past this section real quick. Next section. So after you create your bot, you're going to get an access token. After you view it once, it's not going to show you the access token anymore. So you need to copy and paste it somewhere. If you want to view your access token again, it's going to regenerate it and break your bot. So you do not want to do that. So copy your access token and paste it in your clipboard. And go back to your browser tab where your Spark application is at, web.ciscospark.com, and start a new conversation by clicking the plus sign in the middle top, and enter in your bot's username and go to chat. So now you're in a room with your bot, and if nothing is happening, then you're doing it right. Nothing can happen because you need to create a web hook. That's what web hooks are for. We're going to hook things together and make things work.
Raise your hand if you're stuck. We'll have someone help you out. Okay.
Did you get a Cloud9 account?
Uh-oh.
Can you put the URL for the icon? Yeah, I have it memorized. I'll just type it.
Anyone need help? Okay. Denise?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Question? Sure. Go to the very top. Developer.ciscospark.com. And then my apps.
So this is on the developer.ciscospark.com page.
Click on plus.
Where you click the little plus, and you're going to add your Spark bot there. So it's not going to say my awesome bot. It's going to say the name of your bot at sparkbot.io. And then you'll click go chat.
Anyone need more time? Good? Anyone need more time? Good.
Yes. All right. So for those waiting, I'm going to give you a mission. You've added your Spark bot. So now you can chat with it. Go ahead and type a message to it. Type something to it. And what happens? You should see nothing. Nothing happens because we haven't programmed the bot to do anything yet.
And then create a unique ID. And make sure you remember the Olivier at Spark.io. And then the icon, I will type it in. That's good. Me type in the icon.
Add bot.
And then go to your Cisco Spark and create a room with your bot. Yep. Should be right up here. And then create a new room by clicking on X and then plus. And then type in your bot's address in there. Yep, that's it. That's your bot. Great. Yes.
Cloud 9. I'm stuck here. Nothing happened.
Did you already create an account? Username and password?
No, not yet.
Did you open this from, can you start from your email?
Yes.
Did you use it from your email?
Yes.
Can you go there again? Let me see what it looks like. Create a new account. Scroll down.
Ah.
There we go.
Okay.
Sure. Do you have access to the material after the course? Or?
Yes, I
can do it right now.
So
should we do it now? Or
she wants to know if she can have access to the slides.
Yeah.
Should we give it to them now? Because I can do it in a couple minutes.
Okay.
2 minutes.
Yeah, they'll also be posted like on Cisco.
This is a live stream site.
them, but it's not until after
it up and follow up.
Do you
want it right now?
Delay it for
no,
some time until they are. And
okay. Yeah. Right after it's done, I'll upload it into a slideshow website and make a link for it. Yeah. All right. Anyone else need more time? We have plenty of time, so don't be shy. All right. Let's go ahead and deploy your bots on the cloud, so that way you can access it on any computer. So we already went through the sign-up steps. Everyone should have a Cloud9 account. So go ahead and click on New Workspace or New App or whatever the new button is. And you should see this screen here. You're going to create a workspace name, which is also a unique ID, which means it needs to be all lowercase and no spaces. To make it easy, just use, you know, your name and your dash last name or something like that, and it'll be almost guaranteed unique. Create a description, my first Cisco Spark bot via the DevNet Learning Labs. With your free account, you can only create one private space, which means no one can access it, so you're welcome to check that. Or you can make it public so anyone can view it instead of just you. You have free unlimited public apps for your educational account. You're going to type in a GitHub URL. This is where all the code is located if you're not familiar with GitHub. So whenever we update the code, it'll automatically update on your end. And click on the template node.js. Going back to the URL, it's https://github.com/ciscodevnet/node-sparkbot-samples. So that's the URL you are inputting in the GitHub clone field. I'll give it another minute so you can finish typing in the URL. So this is a SparkBot JavaScript application written with Node.js. And Node.js is a framework made with JavaScript, a JavaScript framework. And I chose Node because it's much faster and doesn't require a lot of setup to get started with. Whereas if we used Python, there's a lot more configuration involved and would take much longer, in my opinion. There's always faster ways to do things, but that's just my excuse to not use it. All right, anyone need another minute? Good? Okay. So when you open up, when you click create, this is what it should look like. I can barely hear myself on here.
Oh, you're loud.
Okay. So when you clone the repo, these are where all the files went. They're all on the side. And this is what your application looks like. Oh, this is the README file, I mean. So your README file is right here. So you're going to want to go to the bottom where you can type in your command. So we're going to create a command where we're going to install Node. So in the terminal on the bottom, first tab, just type in npm install without the quotes, npm install, and it'll put in the Node.js libraries into your application. After you do that, click on helloworld.js located underneath the examples folder, and then click on the green run button. So let's make sure everyone's caught up on this step. Let's see.
A colon before the two forward slashes.
Yeah, I just didn't follow the last.
Raise your hand if you're stuck.
I'll scroll up and see what your error is. Lowercase letters only. Lowercase letters only.
Not yet.
There it is. Okay, yeah, I'm showing this for him. Okay. Yeah. Oh, the S is capitalized in SparkBot. Is it working? It's loading.
We're all good here? All right, let's move on to the next section. And one more. So now that we have our application deployed on the cloud, we want to create a couple variables to get your Spark API connected to this cloud. So on the bottom right corner, there's a button called ENV. ENV. So if you click on that, you'll notice there are fields where you can enter names and values. So you're going to add two items to that, those fields. Debug, make sure it's all in caps. It's case sensitive. And enter your Spark and enter the value SparkBot. The second one is spark underscore token, and copy and paste your API token. That token is the token I told you to copy after you created your SparkBot, the API key generated for you, and you need to copy that value down. Make sure you click on run first before you get to this point. After you click on run, you should be able to see that option on the bottom corner.
No problem.
And do not type in your token key here. That's your API code token. If you do not see the ENV button, make sure you click on run first. And your API key to access that, check your clipboard where you copied the token. I'll give it another couple minutes.
exception. I mean, a statue.
One more. Well, he's just getting logged back in.
That sign-in screen looks very strange. Let's go back to the main page. C9. You do C9.io.
It's a different screen. Anyone else have any questions? We still have a few minutes before we're going to move on to the next slide. And we are behind schedule, not over schedule, so we have plenty of time. Behind schedule. Did I get those words right? Did I do it backwards?
Yes, you did.
So flip that around, and that's what I meant. So we're ahead of schedule. Excuse my English. Excuse my English. It is my first language, but I didn't grow up with English. It's a long story. Click right there where you can type npm, three letters, npm, space, and then you got it. And then after you, after that finishes, you're going to click on run. And then you're going to enter those variables on the corner. So you're about 1 minute away. Help him find his API key. Got the Spark bot. All right. Looks like everyone is caught up. That's great. We're getting very, very close. So this is what it looks like on the bottom right corner. I can't remember if there's an asterisk at the end or not. For some reason, it landed in my screenshot I took. So if it's not working at the end, then so just make sure it just says Spark bot. If it doesn't work at the end, throw in that asterisk. Did you use an asterisk or not when you put in the variables when you tested?
I never
it out?
Did it.
Never. Okay.
Like I never.
Confused I confused myself.
All right. So. After you click in, after you type in your variables, restart your application with the circle button right here, and it should restart it. And then next. And now you are going to get the link to your application. You're going to need that link to create a webhook. So click on Share at the top right corner, and you'll see three options. You want to look at your application, click on Public, and that way Spark API can access this URL, and copy this link in the middle. You need that link, you need that URL to create a webhook. Copy that onto your clipboard or a notepad where you can use it later. Anyone have any questions on where to find this section? What's that?
What is the webhook?
On what?
What is the webhook? You mentioned the webhook.
Oh, I'll get there. And we're gonna connect Spark in this and push commands into the Spark API. It's already public, so just copy the URL. If you already created a public application, it should be defaulted to being checked, so you do not need to check it. So just copy that URL into your notepad. Next.
Yep.
So we're going to create webhook events. Webhooks allows things to get connected together and make a notification or push information out. Unless you have a better explanation of webhooks.
Yeah, I think of, is my mic on? Oh, it's on now. Okay. So, yeah, I think of notifications or webhooks as like a notification tool. So you can program webhooks to say, like, when this happens, do this, right? So it notifies your application anytime a specific event occurs. That's what a webhook is.
So these are webhooks right here called listeners. Messages created, memberships created. So this is what's happening. Next. So back to the developer.ciscospark.com tab that you should have open. Click on webhooks on the left where it says API reference, and you'll see memberships, rooms, and so forth. The very bottom one is webhooks. So you're going to want to click on webhooks under the API reference on developer.ciscospark.com. So your authorization should be defaulted and already have your information there. For your name, you want to enter anything you want, a webhook to Cloud9. You're hooking Spark API to Cloud9. Your target URL, you should have a URL copied. Paste that URL on the second line. The third is resource. Type in messages. And the fourth is events. Type in created. We want to create a message. You'll see those words there because they're grayed out. They're not really in there. You're going to have to manually type it in. So I'm going to go around and make sure everyone is caught up. If you are following along, if you are not following along, that is completely fine. Everyone learns differently.
All right. We got two more steps to go. You just need to type in messages and created, and that's good to go.
And after you type in messages and created, click on run, and we're hoping for a 200 success. Type in message.
Copy your. Yeah, you can type the name for
it.
So you should have all four fields filled out here. All four. Created is at the very bottom. So the bottom two are messages and created. So what you're doing here is you're telling Spark to create a webhook. So post means create, right? Create a webhook. You give the webhook a name so that you know what it's for. Your target URL is what we grabbed from Cloud9. The resources, messages, an event is created, meaning anytime anytime a message is created, send that message to our Spark bot, which is hosted on Cloud9.
It's black, and he can't delete. He's deleting it, and it's forcing it in, like no matter what he does. And it was doing that for all the earlier too, so I had to move to Chrome again. I try to tell everyone not to use it.
All right, so I'm going to try to explain what we're doing here. We created a room, and in that room is our SparkBot. We added our SparkBot to the room. So if you type a message into that room, the webhook will be triggered because there's a new message that was created in that room. That webhook will notify our Spark bot, our chat bot, that is hosted on Cloud9. The our chat bot already has code in it. We got it from GitHub. And what it's going to do is then respond to that message into the Spark room. That's like the overall big picture. Do you want me to repeat that again? I know it's a big process.
Any message, right? Any message.
You have to open up your other tabs.
My other tab? Actually, those are in this part.
Can you open up? There we go. So, yeah.
slash hello.
Okay.
Does anyone have any questions?
Everyone's caught up.
All right. So we're setting up the webhook because our chatbot needs to know when somebody types a message into that room that the SparkBot is in. So that's what the webhook is for, is to notify our chatbot that a message was created in that Spark room, so that the chatbot can then reply to that message back into the Spark room. So remember how we had that meme bot where it was like somebody typed like a phrase and then they said use this image and it like created the meme? Like this one is very simple. It's, you know, we're not gonna have an image and everything like that. But what we're doing is we're creating a webhook so that when somebody types a message into the room, the webhook is then triggered and notifies the SparkBot that lives on Cloud 9. And the SparkBot will run the code. That was that Hello World JavaScript file. And then respond with a message back into the Spark room.
And just so it's less confusing, your URL is the access to your application. You can actually paste that into a browser. And you're not seeing like a pretty web page like you'd see on most sites because you're creating an API call. And this call is what, you know, makes all these things happen.
All right. So if you click run, you should get 200 success. That means that your webhook was created.
All right. And if you want, you can make one more webhook to make it work with membership. So if you want your bots to work in a group room, that would require making another webhook. So you'd put in the same information, group web with the name group webhook for Cloud9. Copy the same URL to Cloud9, and then instead of messages and created, you're gonna replace messages with memberships. Memberships and created instead of messages and created. So it's gonna create a webhook to create a message in a group chat. And then click run again. And this is an optional section if you want to try things out on your own. The next section is testing your bot. So go back to web.ciscospark.com and type slash hello.
Yeah, make sure you're in the room with the bot, not in the room, I guess, where you created a room with your neighbor.
Yeah, so at the beginning, we had you create a room with your bot, so make sure you are in there. Oh, do you have any questions? It's not working. Let's double check your webhooks.
Yeah.
And you already did messages and created?
Yeah, I did that
one.
Can
we go back to Cloud9?
Yeah.
Click on ENV. Did you make your variables? You want to double check your token and make sure that's correct.
From inside the app.
go back into developer.ciscospark.com.
Yeah. Go back to
and
that.
And go to My Apps.
My.
Yeah.
And open up your bot.
And I need to regenerate it.
Regenerate it. Copy that. And then put it into Cloud 9. And restart it.
I did it as a public workspace also, so.
Alright. Back to Spark, Web Spark.
Yeah.
We try again.
It doesn't have to be a one-to-one. Because I had him under a.
So is it a group?
It is a test room that I had where I had just added it. So it's a.
That's you're in a group, so that means you have to do a different command.
So okay, so let's do. Well, then.
So one to one room is just slash hello. In the group, you have to do slash.
I have to.
Tag? Yeah. Tag the person and then do slash hello.
Okay, so I. Alright, let's. That would explain it. So if I do at.
Tag bot.
Tag bot. And
space
then
slash hello.
Hello. He knows.
There we go.
Yeah. Okay.
Is anyone having issues, or if it's not working, I can let you know what the issue is. Is everyone's bot working? Yes. If you're having any issues and your neighbor got it, you could ask your neighbor.
Did you create your variables? On your Spark token needs to have your bot's API key in there. Your API key. Copy somewhere. You know how you have your list of you didn't copy it now. Bot works. Awesome. And yours works. Everyone good over here? Yay. And if you created the second webhook, invite your Spark bot to your group room that you created with your neighbors. And to get your bot to work, you have to tag your bot by typing the bot's name first, space, slash hello. Any questions over here? Yay, that looks good. Yep, looks good. Any questions over here? Everything good?
So far,
one step. What is your question?
I forgot to add the bot to the room.
Oh,
well,
okay.
Actually, the room to the right.
Yeah, no problem. Perfect.
Thank you.
Does anyone need more time? Yeah. If you want to, if you created that second webhook where you, instead of typing messages, you type in members, right? Memberships and created, you can add your bot to a group room. And instead of typing /hello, that will not work. You need to tag your bot. So just type in the name, and you should see a drop-down list. And select your bot, and then type space, and then /hello. So before you use a command, you have to tag your bot's name for it to work in a group room.
Can there be multiple bots in a room? I've never seen that before.
So I think the purpose of having to tag your bot is because you can have multiple bots in a room, and different bots can use the same commands.
All right.
So this is the example of a one-to-one room, and this is an example of a group room. And then your bot should respond to you. So if you want to play around with the code, go to helloworld.js, and you can change things around. You can break your bot. You can change the command name. You can restart it in debug mode. And go to the GitHub URL, the repository, and check out the code. Look at the different types of bots. We have a lot of different bot sample code that you can try out and use. And yeah, that's it. Thank you, everyone, for joining. We have a little more time, so you're welcome to stick around and check out our learning labs, learninglabs.cisco.com. And we have a lot of different learning materials. And you can learn how to create a Spark bot in Python. You can learn how to work with all types of different APIs. It's all interactive learning. For the end, make sure you complete your online session evaluation, kind of like a survey, so we can gather data and help make the next workshops and the next 6 Cisco Live events much better. There should only be 4 session evaluations, and you can receive a Cisco Live t-shirt for doing this. And you can use the Cisco Live mobile app to be able to enter the survey. And does anyone know if you have access to the slides from the Cisco Live site? Because I saw a few people with access to the slides, so maybe it was uploaded. And does anyone want a link to the slides? Okay, I'll do that right now. Actually, we're on your computer. I can do it on my computer real quick.
So we had passed out those little cards. Some of them, basically, we have a game going on in the DevNet Zone, and if you guys do sessions, you could follow the instructions, and the instructions are all over in DevNet Zone, and the more sessions you do, you get to earn prizes. So once you hit a certain amount, it'll tell you, and then you go to the info desk to redeem them. And this session does count.
Thank you. about 30 seconds. let's see. So you can access the slides by going to tiny.cc/WIT-sparkbot. So if someone in H row can load up the link to it or type it down, tiny.cc/WIT-sparkbot. And then you'll have the link to all the slides. Does anyone want the link to the slides?
Thank you.
No problem. Thank you. Anyone want the link to the slides? We're good? Okay. What was that? tiny.cc/wit-sparkbot. CC, CSS, that's cascading style sheets. Yep, that's the link to the slides. If you need gray leggings, we have that information right here. Oh, okay. The session ID is 1056, DevNet-1056. I think lunch will be served around 1 or 1:30 range. What time is it? 12? Okay. They can. So you are all welcome to hang out and work on more stuff and extend your bot or make more REST API calls, or you're welcome to do what you please. Check out the DevNet Zone. We have a lot of different areas for learning about what we have to offer in our developer program. Please visit our information booth. Please visit each section. It'll make us very happy. And thank you.